This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas and Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God. Amen. Thank God. Praise God. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4 tell us what the gospel is. How that Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried. He rose again the third day according to the scripture. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Thank God. The word is neither even in your heart and in your mouth. It is a word of faith which I preach. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Thank God. Thank God. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God and salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. Well, welcome this broadcast, all of you, receiving it on television, and thank God, live stream, Roku, YouTube, other devices, also shortwave. Thank God. Welcome, everyone. Water of Life Boys will be opening, ministering in song, followed by Kathie Davidson, followed by some special music. And at the end, you're going to get me. Water of Life Boys.
As I look around me in these days we're living in, I question how much longer will it be till the Father reaches over, touch his Son, say, Jesus, go bring our family home to me. And only the redeemed shall hear his voice on that day, when he comes in clouds of glory to catch his bride. Till now we've been looking through a glass so dark and dim, and only a few mysteries have we
shout, and God's trumpet will be gone. And only the redeemed shall hear his voice on that day, when he comes in clouds of glory to catch us all.
What's wonderful about the gospel? 4 o'clock this morning, I couldn't have been standing here. I went to bed ill last night. I was very nauseous. My throat was on fire. I had a headache. I couldn't stand. I was weak and shaky. 4 o'clock this morning, Doyle had his own fight. I had mine. So I went downstairs at 4 o'clock this morning, and I pulled up my program that I did last Sunday morning. It was anointed. And I joined my faith with that anointing, and about 5 minutes into it, I started laughing. I started laughing because the gospel is that Jesus died for me, and he was buried for me, and he was raised again for me. And when I finished laughing, here I am. It was all gone. Most of it was gone. And I went back to bed for an hour. It's great. Now, I'm going to challenge you again this morning. Do you believe the Bible? You know, all the denominations, all the different churches we go to, if you say you're Christian, we should have something in common, and that's the Bible, the Word of God. It's written in the Word of God that it is forever. The Word of God was before the earth was created, and the Word of God will be here after the word, after the world disappears. The Word of God is forever. Jesus himself said the Word of God cannot be broken. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Let's take a look. I'm going to answer some questions you might have had your whole life. I want you to turn to Exodus 34. I'm going to begin in verse 5. This is God revealing his own personality to Moses. God telling Moses what he's really like. The best way to find out about somebody is to let them tell you about themselves. Here, the God, Jehovah, the God of heaven, is going to tell Moses exactly what he's like. Let's see what it says. Verse 5, and the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious. This is God. This is Jehovah who doesn't change. He said, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Now notice this next part. and it will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation. Do you see what that word says? I'm going to read it again to you. That last part says, and will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity, the sin of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children and upon the third and fourth generation. Oh, but he's a loving God. The word doesn't say that right there, does it? Does it? God is just. He's God. And the word of God doesn't change. God doesn't change. I said this last week. The same God in the Old Testament is the same God in the New Testament. He didn't change. He doesn't change. He's God. The only thing that changed was the covenant. Now, go with me to Deuteronomy 28. What does sin bring? Verse 15. But it shall come to pass that if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee. You ever wonder where those curses came from? All these curses shall come upon thee. Why? Because you didn't obey God. Because you didn't do what God told you to do. And what happens when you don't do what God tells you to do? It tells you right here, 16. Cursed shall thou be in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field. Cursed shall be thy basket in thy store. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy land, and the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shall thou be when thou goest out. And the Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, rebuke, in all that thou settest thy hand unto to do, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly, because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me. Whereby thou hast forsaken me. And I can hear you now say, oh, but that's the Old Testament. Oh, you mean all those curses have disappeared? You mean we don't have any of that stuff anymore? Have you been outside your house lately? The curses never went away. Now, turn with me to Joshua 7. Find out what happens when we don't obey God and these curses come upon us. Joshua 7, 12. Therefore, the children of Israel, this is the children of Israel, they went out to fight Ai. They went out to fight Ai. God was with them, with Jericho. They go out to get Ai. 36 men die. Why? Says it right here. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their back before their enemies because they were accursed. Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed thing from among you. You see what happens when you're cursed? God's not with you. God is not with you. Have you ever wondered why there were some people that it looked like it didn't matter what they did, it was going to fail? Have you ever felt that way? That no matter what you did, no matter where you went, no matter how hard you tried, it failed. I remember we went through a period of time in our house when I was in Frisco. I have four children. And it seemed like we went through a period that they were getting cuts, lacerations. I mean, I was always taking somebody to the doctor to stitch them up. They wouldn't get sick, but they'd get cuts. And it'd be 7 stitches or 15 stitches or 4 stitches. I mean, it was an ongoing thing. I made a joke one time about I'm going to keep the thread and the needle at home. I didn't understand what was going on until one day it dawned on me. My God, this is a curse. This is a curse. And I started asking some questions about my family and my husband's family, and I found out that there was a family that the same thing was happening to them. What does it say? It says the visits the iniquity on the third and fourth generation. You say, well, that's not fair. He's God. Go ahead and argue with him. See what happens. You're going to lose. Amen. Third and fourth generation. I broke the curse over my children about getting lacerations. And you know what? After I broke that curse, we never had another stitch. Amen. We have never had another stitch because of a cut or a fall or something like that. Never had one. Why? The curse was broken. How did that happen? Now, turn with me to Galatians 3. 13. This is Jesus. I'm going to begin in verse 11. But by no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident. For the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith. Did you hear that? The law is not of faith. But the man that doeth them shall live in them. Now look at verse 13. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. Being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Let's go back and see where that happened. I want you to go back to Deuteronomy for me. This is a wonderful scripture if you see it in the gospel. Verse 22 of Deuteronomy 21. And if a man has committed a sin worthy of death, if a man have committed a sin worthy of death, and he be put to death, thou shalt hang him on a tree. And his body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day. For he that is hanged is accursed of God. Accursed of God. A man hanging on a tree is accursed of God, that thy land be not defiled, which the Lord thy God has given thee for an inheritance. A man hanging on the tree is accursed of God. Of God. Guess where that man's going to go? A man hanging on a tree is accursed of God. Who put Jesus on the tree? The Father did. Jehovah himself made the way for Jesus to hang on a tree. So you know what that made Jesus? That made the Savior of the world, the one that healed all those nations of people, all those thousands of people, all that man that did all those miracles, put him on a tree and he became accursed of God. Accursed. Do you know that man went from he that knew no sin became sin? And when Jesus was hanging on that tree, he was the absolute worst man ever to be on a tree. The worst man ever to die. The worst man ever. Because he had our sin on him. My sin. Your sin. Not sin in general. Our sins. Do you know Jesus died a murderer? Do you know he died a child molester? Do you know he died a thief? He died a liar? He died an extortioner? He died a mass murderer. Jesus died sin. He died an adulterer. He died a perverse sex. He died of lying. He died of manipulation. He died of self-righteousness. He died of pride. He died of unbelief. He died an unbeliever. Jesus became a curse for us, and God counted him accursed. The God that he was with daily, God turned his back on him. In Habakkuk, it says that he can by no means, by his eyes, look on sin. He turned his back on Jesus because Jesus was the worst. He died the absolute worst, accursed of God. And then he went to hell. Because that's where sinners go. And he was the worst. And it says in the Psalms, he went to the lowest hell. Why? Because he was the worst sinner. Why? Because he was doing it for you. He was doing it for you. Whatever you were, he became. You have sin in your life, Jesus became it. And he was accursed of God. I can hardly imagine that Jehovah looked on Jesus and saw him as accursed. Wicked, sin, the worst. And he went to hell for it. For you. For you. for you. Isn't that amazing? He did it for you. He became a curse for us so that we can get rid of the curses. So that we can get rid of the curses. You know that curse with my children always getting lacerated? You know what? That curse went away. Why? Because Jesus became a curse for us. It didn't matter if I had sinned, my grandfather had sinned, my mother had sinned, my great-grandfather had sinned. It didn't matter. Jesus bore it on the cross. He bore it on the cross, and I broke the power of that curse, and it's gone. You know, I forgot all about this until this morning. When I was in late high school, early college, I was trying to obey God. I was tithing when I worked in a restaurant. I was going to several churches. I was seeking God. It's when I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I had some female problems that I considered severe. When my period started, I would faint. The pain was so bad, I couldn't get out of bed. So every 28 days in school, I wasn't there. I couldn't do it. And I finally talked to my mother, and she finally took, you know, I don't go to doctors very much. I think I saw 3 doctors growing up. Anyway, I went to the doctor. She took me to the doctor, and he gave me these horse pills. I swear they're that big. He said, this will take care of the cramps. Okay. I obeyed the doctor. The first time, when it came again, I mean, they hurt. Friends, they hurt. They really hurt. I couldn't do anything but lay in bed. So I took one pill. Now I'm laying in bed and feeling all sorts of craziness. I said, I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't handle this. I mean, I'm less than 100 pounds, and I'm taking a pill that's half my size. You know, and I mean, I could, to be honest, it felt like I was losing control of my facilities. And I said, I'm not doing this. And I took the jar, and I tossed it in the toilet. And I had a friend that said, you know, you could have sold those on the street for quite a bit. Come on. So it caused somebody else to sin. Anyway, I threw them in the toilet, and I told God, I said, I need help. I need help. You know what? He broke the curse. From that day forward, I never had that again. I never had the pain again. I never fainted again. God broke the curse. I didn't even realize what happened until this morning. I just knew there was a day when I threw those pills away. I was done. It was done. It was gone. God broke the curse. Do you know what? You can do the same. You don't need to go to a special man of God to break a curse in your life. You got Jesus in you. You have the man that was raised from the dead in you. You have a man that knows that curse because he carried it for you in his own body. And when God raised him from the dead, he raised you with him. And now if you are born again, you have that man in you. You have the spirit of that man in you. And he's not afraid of curses. He has seen the worst. He is not afraid of you. He has carried the worst. He was the worst. You know, you can't say you were the worst anymore. Jesus was. Jesus was, because he was carrying you. He was carrying you. You can believe. We are going to have some musicians coming up here. We're going to have the Water of Life boys. They're going to come and they're going to do adoration. We are going to have Terry and the Browns and Paul Peters. They're going to sing at Calvary. And then we're going to have Paul Peters. He's going to come and sing, I'd Rather Have Jesus. Love that song. And Terre Brown's going to come up and sing God on the Mountain. That song's anointed. While they're singing, join your faith with them and us and break those curses over your life. You know right now what you need to be breaking. Break them over your life and let's have the gospel reign over the devil. Amen.
Praise in one. Praise, 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 praise. In one accord we praise you, O Lord. Glory and honor and power.
That brought it down to man. The God of the day. and your talk comes so easy. Life's at its best, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptation. That's when your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain, he's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times, he's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. Yes, you talk of faith when you're up on your mountain, and your talk comes so easy. Life's at its best, but it's down in that valley of trials and temptation. That's when your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain, he's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times, he's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God. God of the day, he's still God in the night. Oh, the God of your day, he's still God in your night.
Hallelujah! Thank God. Is everybody awake? I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to those people out there. Thank God. I want to say hello, South Bend, Indianapolis, New Orleans. I'm back.
Amen.
You know who brought me back? You want to come back? Say what I say. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus. Well, come on. Where's your faith? Mix faith with the name of Jesus, and you'll come out. You'll come back. Jesus. 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 Jesus.
Jay, 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 J Yeah.
Something with you. 40 years ago, 1975, Kansas City, Missouri, 3,500 men gathered at a meeting, and I was there with three guys from Texas. I could not get my voice, words out of my mouth. No, when I was getting ready to go to the meeting, I couldn't get words out. They were right here, like they almost are now. And you want to know why? The devil hates the name of Jesus. There is no name under heaven whereby what must be saved except the name of Jesus. The devil hates that name. The devil wants you to use something else, like Christ. What Christ? Anna? Antichrist? How about Jesus Christ? And I kneeled at that meeting in my room to pray. I told the three with me, I've got to pray. They looked at me like, what's wrong with you? I kneeled, and words would not come out. In about, I don't know how long, I was whispering, down here, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I broke through. The power of God broke me through. I go out to that meeting, and the leader says, take your shoes off, we're on holy ground. I thought, oh my God, here we go. Oh, I've been in your holy ground meetings, but mine, I mean, it's God, and yours isn't most of the time. Amen. And I got on my knees on the concrete floor. Amen. And we stayed there 30 minutes, and nothing happened. Absolutely nothing. I kept changing from one knee to another. I thought, good Lord, have mercy on me. Mercy, 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 grace, mercy. Finally, they gave up. You know why? No one could do anything. Unbelief. Unbelief. You know, I sense unbelief everywhere I go. I sense it in every meeting. On television, on radio, shortwave, live stream, Roku, YouTube, other devices, unbelief. Did you know in the 18th chapter of Luke, Jesus said, when I return, shall I find faith on the earth? That's a shocking statement. Shall I find faith on the earth? In the book of Acts, 4th chapter, Peter and John went up to the temple to pray, and there was a man sitting there. Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise and walk. The guy jumped up, started leaping and praising God. And it says in the 4th chapter, faith in that name made this man have gave him perfect soundness. God bless you. I will see you next time. Have a good one.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.